the Lord Napier Public House in Thornton Heath. It features live traditional jazz 4 nights a week, has done so for 12 years. Bill Brunskill, trumpet player and band leader, born 1920. He's led a jazz band for around 32 years. Bill has never been a household name, never turned professional, never before made a TV appearance or broadcast. Nevertheless, over the years, he has played in front of thousands of people, many of them regularly, for a shorter or longer period of their lives. Whatever happened to Bill Brunskill? I've been asked that question all over the world, from Australia to, of all places, Mexico City. People who've heard and enjoyed Bill's music at some time during the last 30 years. People who love jazz. Whatever happened to Bill Brunskill? Whatever happened to this kind of jazz since it caught on in Britain over 40 years ago? Bill's lived through it all.
A survivor of the battlefield of jazz styles, of a passionate clash of musical ideas.
Tonight, all over the country, in pubs and clubs, bands are playing this kind of music. There's not much money in it, only local celebrity. Most of the musicians, like Bill, are semi-pro, few of them young. Why do they do it? How long has it been going on? The war years, bad news, bombing, rationing, but a mood of dogged, usually cheerful determination. Popular music then offered either a rather touching schmaltz, epitomized by Vera Lynn, the Force's sweetheart, or the music of the big American swing bands, Miller, Goodman, and Shaw, and their British imitators. Schmaltz or swing, we'll meet again, or in the mood. But a secret society was forming. A widespread and growing minority of young people were developing a passion for a form of music long out of fashion, early jazz. From the studies of public schools, from suburban villas, in army barracks, on ships, on aerodromes, the sound of jazz on record grew more persistent. Somehow its converts made contact and would meet to talk, analyze, and above all to play their rare, precious, and hideously fragile 78s. Information was thin on the ground. Myth was taken as fact, but gradually a pantheon was established.
We knew that jazz was born in New Orleans, but most of our interest was centered on the music played in Chicago during the 20s. King Oliver. Early Louis Armstrong. Jelly Roll Morton. It's Spiderbeck. Sidney Bechet. And Bessie Smith. These were our gods and goddesses. We waited anxiously for the infrequent reissues. We scoured the tottering piles of records in the junk shops. Our knowledge was sketchy and dogmatically inaccurate, but there was no denying our passion.
As the lovers of early jazz gained in numbers and confidence, they began to infiltrate those pre-war sanctums of hot music, the rhythm clubs. These rather solemn institutions, with their rejection of the outdated word jazz, met to listen to record recitals, and afterwards, although very much as an afterthought, there was usually a jam session where swing-orientated musicians improvised. But it was only a question of time before the young revivalists, as they'd begun to call themselves, took the next step to recreate their kind of music. The first revivalist jazz band was probably formed by a South London factory worker, George Webb.
George now runs a pub near Stansted Airport. I asked him how, back in the early war years, he came to pioneer the jazz revival.
So when Bryce turned up one day and gave a record recital, he was living in Eltham, invited me over there, and he used to get his trumpet out and have a little blow. And at that time I was dabbling about on the piano a bit with chords, and we used to sit there and fool around, and I used to go on a Saturday night to a club where Owen played, just as a social thing, and they invited me up there when they took the interval to have a little blow with him, and we used to trot into stuff like Royal Garden Blues. And because we started to enjoy it, we started rehearsing in the front room at Brampton Road, where I was living in Bexley Heath. Well, suddenly out of the blue, Eddie Harvey turns up at my lunch table in the factory and introduces himself. He was a pupil to come there and said he was interested in the trombone and he played. And so I invited him along to have a blow, and he asked if he could bring his friend along, a clarinet player named Wally Fawkes, which he did. And then suddenly we got a front line. We had a trombone, trumpet, clarinet, and we started playing tunes we liked.
So, as at the start of most movements, chance made certain that the right people met up at the right time. And where did the band begin to play regularly? At a rhythm club, the Red Barn, a public house on the outskirts of southeast London. At first, their music, unfamiliar and pretty rough and ready, emptied the bar, but gradually things improved.
Like everything else, as bad as you are, if you play often enough, you've got to get better. And we started working at it seriously, because there's nobody else down there to play, and we was rehearsing three or four times a week, 2 or 3 hours, and gradually we built up a following of 50 or 60 people down there.
When did the music you were playing begin to get to the public?
A chap named Jack Marshall, who was a melody maker, photographer, a big friendly man, he invited the band to play. He came to the Red Barn and heard it. I think Max Jones brought him down. And he invited us to play at the Feldman Club, which is now the 100 Club in Oxford Street. People listened to the band then, and from then it got good reports from the melody maker, and people started inviting us to play in places.
And so the George Webb Dixielanders brought to life the sound that jazz fans up until then had only been able to hear on record. And in consequence packed not only the Red Barn, but concert halls both in London and the provinces. The next important step in their development was the recruitment of a young Exetonian, recently demobbed guards officer called Humphrey Littleton.
Jimmy Godbolt brought Humph down, and he was happy to sit in with the band and play with the band. And we had no idea that Humph would ever want to join the Dixielanders, and Owen Bryce suggested to me that we ask Humph to join. I never thought he'd join, and when I asked Humph, he said, yeah, sure. He was happy, and there we are. That revolutionized the whole thing. There we have an ace trumpet player.
Was he, in your view, a very superior player to most of
those? Oh, very superior player. He was the catalyst of the thing. The jazz scene would never have survived without Littleton, because As you know, when my band subsequently broke up, Hump formed his own band with some of my musicians, and then after a while I rejoined the Hump band and we reorganised it, and I was happy to say that when we parted company in the 50s, we achieved things. We was on record, we'd done what we wanted to do. But it couldn't have happened without Littleton.
So what made Humphrey Littleton decide to leave George Webb and set up on his own?
Wally and I had got into trouble with George and his manager, Jim Godbolt, for sitting in with Freddie Randall's band. They didn't like, they thought that the our music would be diluted if we went around sitting in with different people. And somehow I felt that very strict revivalist approach was not what I wanted to do. And I think, generally speaking, I had a lot of ideas and I wanted to have my own band and put them into practice. And I got an impression from the conversations I had with Wally that if I left George and eventually started up my own band, that Wally would probably come in with me. But we didn't sort of hatch a plot and leave George as a sort of, you know, in a sort of palace revolution. I left in, I think, November of 47, on my own, but knowing pretty well that at least one or two of George's people would come with me when the time came.
Revivalist jazz was not to remain under the solemn wing of the rhythm clubs for long. In the winter of 1947, from Australia came a band of irreverent, talented extroverts, led by a piano player called Graham Bell.
Graham took one look at the hot club or rhythm club scene that was over here, where people used to go along on a special night of the week. They used to sit solemnly there, listening to the music and comparing it with their records that they had at home, and checking up on the tunes that we played with their discographies and so on. And Graham was absolutely horrified by this, and he started with me the first Jazz for Dancing club that was ever known over here. And some of the dancing was very funny because nobody had any idea. One or two people knew of the sort of modified jitterbug dancing, jivey, which had come from the palais, you know, and, American camps that introduced it here and all that. So that had a certain basic routine, but a lot of people just jumped in and thrashed about.
By the time the Bell Band returned to Australia in the autumn of 1948, the whole approach of the revivalists had changed radically, and the music had begun to attract a far wider public.
A lot of people used to come along from the art school who used to come to the club, first of all at Leicester Square and then at 100 Oxford Street when he started there, expressly to do their own thing. It was the first manifestation, really, I think, of young people deciding what sort of music they wanted to hear, how they wanted to carry on in a dance place, and what they wanted to wear.
By the end of the 40s, revivalist jazz had spread nationwide. While Hump's Club at 100 Oxford Street could be described as the cathedral of the movement, there were many other churches in which jazz was preached. In Edmonton, for example, at a pub called Cook's Ferry Inn, Freddie Randall was the resident band, and there were even some who preferred his brash but lively form of Dixieland to Humph's more subtle approach. Bands proliferated, most of them picturesquely named. The Mike Daniels Delta Jazz Band, Mick Mulligan's Magnolia Jazz Band, Denny Coffey and his Red Hot Beans. Revivalist jazz was by no means confined to London. There were jazz clubs in every major city and many smaller towns, and local bands to play in them. In Manchester, the Saints. In Leeds, the Yorkshire Jazz Band. In Liverpool, the Merseysippers. Nor was jazz confined to pubs and clubs. There were concerts, art school and university thrashes, And in summer, riverboat shuffles, named in honor of the dances held aboard the Mississippi paddle steamers. By the beginning of the 50s, you could wake up each day with a certain knowledge that before you went to bed, you were going to hear jazz. For those of us involved, it was a golden age. But like all faiths, the revivalists needed an enemy, an established heresy. Filling this role were the modernists, the disciples of bebop.
Usually professional dance band musicians, they were able to appreciate the stylistic innovations of the contemporary masters playing in New York. Charlie Parker. Dizzy Gillespie. Thelonious Monk. Ronnie Scott was one of the British pioneers of modern jazz. For him, our preoccupation with revivalism was incomprehensible.
You know, we could never understand, or at least I couldn't ever understand, why a young man, as we all were in those days, wanted to play a music of 20 or 30 years ago, you know, to recreate what had already been created and done. Whilst we were all aware that revivalist jazz was the basis, it was a stepping stone, as it were, and without it, I don't suppose contemporary jazz would have existed. Nevertheless, we couldn't understand why young guys wanted to be involved in that music and not want to play what was the music we thought of as of the time.
At that time, there was an absolute division between the two schools. There were completely different lifestyles. Do you remember that?
It seemed to us, I mean, we were very keen and very American-minded in those days. To us, jazz was a Native American music, and if it went out of that context, then it wasn't jazz music. And you guys probably felt the same way. I mean, the great traditionalists or revivalists were American, but we were also aware of the fashions of the day. We used to wear American shirts and American ties, you know, and American suits, and that was the really sharp way to dress in those days. Whereas the revivalists didn't seem to care how they dressed, and looked like, you know, the original beatniks. And so they used to go around with girls that looked like middle-class dropouts with National Health specs and long hair, whereas we went for the more glamorous kind of young lady, if you like.
But bebop remained, until its language became familiar, a minority taste. In 1950, an important event took place, a jazz band ball at the Hammersmith Palais. It was the first great manifestation of the revivalist movement, and it was a huge commercial success. This didn't escape the attention of several wily promoters, who up until then had considered revivalism an irrelevant joke. To cash in, they promoted a series of mammoth London concerts, booking as many bands as possible to play for about 10 minutes each. In consequence, each tried to outshine the others by playing faster and louder, and for a time, jazz suffered badly. It was a lesson that should have been learnt, but it wasn't. The whole generation of those whom the press called the angry young men were all jazz lovers. Jimmy Porter, the protagonist of Look Back in Anger, had this to say.
Mr. Porter! Mr. Porter!
Anybody who doesn't like jazz has no real feeling for music or for people.
Rubbish.
See what I mean?
Well, I think old Jimmy Porter at one stage does say, I don't think I could ever love anyone who didn't enjoy jazz, or something like that. And I think it was really rather my own feeling at the time, that if you couldn't respond to that spontaneity and open-heartedness, there was something wrong about your spirit.
And as important as the music itself was our dream of the city where jazz was born, New Orleans, the land of dreams, our dreams.
Fantasy. When you read all the books about the Red Lamp District and all these guys playing throughout the night and the people dancing, the skiffle people playing on street corners and people shuffling around. The river boat going up and down. I suppose in lots of cases there must have been a tremendous dust hole in some respects, but on the other hand, a magical thing. And out of all that turmoil and whatever you like, comes this beautiful music. Thank God it did.
But we were all terribly aware of it. It was like Byzantium, didn't it? And all those red light district and those people dancing at funerals. And as I think you said, it was completely in contrast to the timorous and dullness of what English life seemed to be at the time.
Well, it was very much the land of dreams, in the words of the old song. One treasured anecdotes or was horrified by some. I mean, when we learned, I don't know who found this, that Leon Rappello, the clarinetist of the New Orleans Rhythm Kings, a white man, had gone mad on something called marijuana, I believe, because it helped him to play jazz. And he had been found, when he was missing, he was found leaning against a telegraph pole, playing his clarinet to the accompaniment of the wind singing through the telephone wires. And a gasp of horror and admiration went round.
None of us had ever been to New Orleans, but when we left our local jazz club, we strutted down Basin Street. Although New Orleans, back in the days when jazz was born, was the city of revivalist dreams, we were about to awake with a shock to its living musical reality. In 1949, a band was formed by a London train cleaner, Ken Colyer. It was called the Crane River Jazz Band, a harmless enough name, but it was to split the revivalist jazz world. Ken called his music traditional jazz. The war was on. Ken believed that the basis of revivalism, the jazz recordings made during the 20s by musicians who'd quit New Orleans, was a decadent development. He maintained that true jazz had never left the Crescent City. His idol was Bunk Johnson, an old and obscure New Orleans trumpet player, long retired, who was rediscovered in the late 30s. From then until his death in 1949, Bunk became a living legend. Ken believed this to be the true jazz. There was no other.
When I first cottoned on to Bunk, I admit I slavishly tried to copy him. But Bunk was a wonderful teacher, which I realized it wasn't just to try and copy them, and it really is a waste of time just becoming a carbon copy of anybody.
Following Bunk's example, Collier formed a strictly traditional New Orleans band as he conceived it.
And I had to drill it into them then. They weren't avid about the music like I was at the time, but I coerced them and influenced them. I don't know today whether it was ever to their regret, but it was my personality and driving force that made the band what it was.
You were a tremendous influence. Many musicians who'd been happily playing revivalist jazz moved over to playing traditional jazz.
Yes, but it's an unfortunate thing, in a way, that the jazz world became so partisan. I mean, it wasn't a good thing at all, but that's the way it happens. You had your avid people that believed only Louis Armstrong's Hot 5 and Hot 7, that was the only way to play. And so Jelly Roll Morton, that was the only way to play. And then there was all this conflict within the jazz scene, which was a shame, because conflict like that wastes a lot of energy and a lot of time that could be put to better use.
Yeah. Although you were in part responsible for that conflict.
Yes.
While Collier's fundamentalist traditional gospel was attracting fans and musicians in increasing numbers, a further blow to revivalism came from within its own beleaguered walls. Humphrey Lyttelton, the king of revivalist jazz, had long been growing restless and decided to abdicate.
And then in 1956, Wally Fawkes left the band. We were doing much more touring, and he wanted to stay, you know, he didn't want to, he had his cartoonist job. And so he left. And that was really when I was faced with the crunch. What was I going to do? I made an album, a 10-inch album called Hump Swings Out, soon after Wally left the band, in which I decided not to let Bruce Turner play clarinet at all. So we had alto, trumpet and trombone, which was the nearest we could get to the opposite of a traditional front line, mainly just to see what happened and to establish that. And I actually did an interview, I think, in the Melody Maker saying, I am no traditionalist, you know. So I really, my people who were, you know, my bank manager and Lynn Dutton, who was my manager then, and that, all thought that I'd taken leave of my senses. And to an extent, I suppose I had, because literally months after I decided to turn my back on that traditional camp, the band started getting things in the hit parade, and the trad boom blew up, and there was I with an 8-piece band with 3 saxophones.
But what finally won the war for the traditionalists was a gesture on the part of the movement's founder, Ken Collier. In retrospect, it appears almost inevitable.
These men were still playing in New Orleans. They weren't all that old. And they must still be there and still playing. So the logical thing was to get there while they were still playing. And the only way I could think of doing this at the time was to rejoin the Merchant Navy and somehow or other find a boat that took me to New Orleans. They were looking for crew for this Empire Petrae, which was sailing out of Mobile, Alabama. As soon as I heard Mobile, Alabama, oh, that's near enough. So I don't take any more chance. You know, this is as near as I'm going to get. So I deserted the ship and got the Greyhound bus to New Orleans.
It was a very strong color bar then. How did you get over that?
The color ban was very strict at the time, and there were problems, but I've often felt that it's the old saying, fools go where angels fear to tread, and I took chances sometimes, and even the band did, though, because they were aware, you know, the color thing was a problem, but I did eventually manage to play with George Lewis.
Playing with the heroes that you'd admired from afar, did it confirm you in your belief, and did you feel you learnt a lot from it?
Well, that's why I went there, was to confirm the courage of my convictions. I thought, well, if I'm wrong, I'm wrong, but am I? It's the only way to find out is to go there and play with these men. And they fully restored my faith in humanity, music, and everything.
When Ken Collier arrived back from New Orleans, he found a band waiting for him. A band willing to go professional and to play strict New Orleans jazz.
It had been formed initially by Chris Barber, a trombonist who'd been around since the beginning of the revival, and it included Monty Sunshine on clarinet and Lonnie Donegan on banjo.
And then we heard that Ken Colyer's come back from New Orleans. He'd just overstayed his permit, been deported, first class, and there is America. Lovely way of getting back. And so we wrote a letter saying, listen, we've got this band. What about coming and joining us? We'll call the band your band. Why not? Because you're the new, you've come up from New Orleans. Everyone wants to see what you play. They all know what we play already. So back he came, and he came along and joined in our rehearsals, and it was ever so good. It really went very, very well. A combination, perhaps, of the classic side of jazz and the revived archaic side together just worked. And it did something. It had, as they say in showbiz, magic of some kind, and clicked.
But magic or not, it didn't last. Ken soon decided, for a mixture of personal and musical reasons, to sack the rhythm section. But Chris pointed out he was not in a position to do so. On the contrary.
So we thought, oh, this is a bit silly. So we turned around within about 5 minutes and said, listen, sorry about this. It happens to be a cooperative band which you joined. You may remember that. You may have forgotten that. But it's a partnership, the band. You can't sack anybody because it's a six-man partnership. And but the other five of us are now sacking you. Goodbye. Leave. You've got 2 weeks. 2 weeks later, he did.
Luckily for Barber, a trumpet player called Pat Halcox, whom he'd long admired, decided to pack in his day job and go professional. The Chris Barber band was complete. Based initially on Collier's traditionalism, it was somehow less rough and more accessible in impact. It began to attract a wide following, and comparatively early, to dilute Ken's strict ideas. It was the first true British trad band, and was to spawn a host of imitators. Yet before trad jazz was to triumph, there was to be a short period in the wilderness. 1955 saw the emergence of the first wave of British rock and roll, inspired by Bill Haley and Elvis Presley, and sparked off by the discovery of Tommy Steele.
Let's go, boy. Gonna have a teenage party. We're gonna have a teenage time. We're gonna make it high and hearty. If you're ready, that's fine.
With revivalism losing ground and traditionalism not yet fully grown, rock and roll offered instant excitement to a generation of adolescents with money in their pockets and the need to revolt. What temporarily did for rock and roll were its middle-aged managers and promoters. They wanted acceptance by the establishment, and to this end pushed the young rebels towards conformity. Tommy Steele and others with talent became all-round entertainers. Their lesser rivals vanished overnight. Trad's hour had come.
When you hear that preaching has begun, bend down low and pray away your sin. When you get that religion, you wanna join and sing. There'll be a hot time in old Saturday night.
Chris Barber attracted larger and larger audiences both here and on the continent. His imitators began to cash in. The whole country rang to the relentless strumming of amplified banjos and the increasingly predictable three-piece front line belting out a small repertoire of approved tunes. Those who remained faithful to revivalism and those who chose to explore the later developments of jazz had a lean time. At best, they were allowed to feed from the crumbs which fell from trad's table. Chris Barber himself was none too happy at the way things were developing.
Really, I felt that trad became it's merchandising and business. I mean, the fact is that if something is popular, then the media have to get onto it because they simply have to, and they must, and they do, and everything gets made bigger. The defects in it become amplified too, and it looks worse and worse. I suppose one really felt it it was hard to criticize it altogether, because it was nice to feel that members of the general public were going along listening to bands playing music which was had some relevance to the music which you really believed in. But sometimes it got so far from it that you really felt My God, they've been led up a gum tree. They're getting the wrong idea entirely.
In 1956, something profoundly important took place. The American and British musicians' unions made up their differences. And for the first time since the war, American jazzmen could play in Britain. Up until then, despite an illicit appearance by Sidney Bechet in 1949, only solo artists, by definition most of them blues singers, had been allowed in. But now the long drought was over. And the first event was the appearance for a week at the Empress Hall, followed by a provincial tour of Louis Armstrong and his All-Stars. The impact on the British jazz world was prodigious.
Well, it's just like one of them old home weeks, you know, homecoming, all the cats from the years when I first come here, blowing out there and just bring back old memories.
Pretty solid, you think?
Yes, more than that.
Well, sir?
Well, I'd say great personified, you know.
He was followed by most of the living masters. The big bands, Ellington and Basie. The Dixieland groups like Eddie Condon. The pyrotechnical jazz at the Phil concerts. Whatever the great musicians lost in mystique, they replaced in conviction and example. In general, British jazz developed a new confidence now that the gods played amongst them. Yet if it was a heady and glorious time for British jazz musicians of all schools, the fans were less impressed. Unlike the revivalist followers, or on the whole knew something of jazz history and collected its records, most of the traditional fans actually preferred the British trad sound, knew little of its origins, and would bother to go and hear American musicians only if they were playing with their favorite band. During the same year that brought us Louis Armstrong, Lord Montague at Bewley in Hampshire instituted an annual open-air festival. From its modest beginnings in 1956, this grew from a single evening to a three-day event, one of the great secular feasts in the traditional jazz calendar.
It was a great coming together of people at a time before really pop music had taken the hold, and it was a great weekend out apart from anything else, and not only was the music very diverse, but of course people also enjoyed the gardens and the bushes and everywhere else.
1958 saw the emergence of an unlikely figure, an amiable clarinet player from Somerset called Acker Bilk. Acker was transformed into an international superstar, a household name. Jazz, for so long a minority interest, became the pop music of its time. And how did the breakthrough come for Acker?
There was a piano player who played with the band in Somerset, Dave Collett, who wrote this tune Somerset, when me and him got together on it in Somerset, and which we recorded on an album. They liked it, and they put it out as a single, and I think it's got number 8 in the charts or something, which was, that was it, you know. God, he's in the pop charts now, you know. There's a lot of people didn't like it, mate, a lot of the jazzers.
No. Yeah. Because it was that rather soft, sentimental side.
Yeah, it was a bit, yeah. I didn't know strings with that one, but piano and banjo on that, you know. It was still banjo on it. I don't know why they're worried about it.
How did the visual image arise, the waistcoat and the bowler hat?
There was a guy called Peter Leslie who suggested the idea of like bowler hats and old sort of New Orleans-ish style waistcoat, whatever that means, but it finished up striped waistcoat and bowler hat.
And the sleeve notes were all written in very elaborate Victorian prose.
Yeah, that was all his doing, yeah, it was all Peter.
And this caught with the public?
It did really, I think, yeah. And then, of course, Dennis Preston had an idea about doing a, because on the strength of Somerset, I think, to do some clarinet things with strings, which we did, and off we went with Strangler on the Floor. The old age pension.
Stranger on the Shore, a sweet-sounding ballad composed for a TV serial, wasn't typical of the music Acker played on the bandstand, but it became a worldwide hit. Following Acker's lead, several bands went in for fancy dress. They were City Gents, Confederate Soldiers, New Orleans Riverboat Gamblers, but even those who preferred ordinary clothes copied the sound, the ubiquitous three-piece front line, the relentless banjo. For a time, the trad world was dominated by what became known as the three B's. Bilk, Barber, and an openly commercial band led by trumpet player Kenny Ball. So great was the demand that many lesser and in some cases hopelessly inadequate musicians went professional. But although there was a great deal of money to be made, some were more cautious. Bill Brunskill, for instance.
No, well, I worked for a local council since I was about 16. And, you know, council jobs in the 30s, they were gilt-edged securities. This was a job that was a pension at the end of it and everything.
The BBC ensured that the sound of trad was seldom off the air and organised huge concerts at the Royal Albert Hall. No other form of jazz was permitted. It was trad for breakfast, dinner and tea. Acker's fans became an army, adopting the bowler hat as a symbol of their allegiance and wearing knee-length sweaters and armless fur coats, which became known as rave gear. One year at Bewley, Acker's fans rioted at the inclusion of modern jazz, much to the dismay of their gentle idol.
Well, that was quite rare. I mean, I think that was the organisers really should have realised, I mean, the feeling about the trad movement, you know, because it was a bit of a movement, really. And to stick a modern band on before us when everybody's waiting for our band or whatever, you know, some other trad band, is a bit stupid, I thought. And there was no fighting, though. They just went a bit mad, didn't they? They got up on the stage and on the piano and got up on this, like a roundabout thing he had for the stage, didn't they? They were on the roof and waving to Mum. There wasn't any thumping about or anything, you know? Not, I mean, I didn't see much of it. And the dangerous thing, as you said, was the getting on that scaffold with the lights, which the whole lot collapsed. And just missed the cables, didn't it? And, you know, it could have been rough there.
Which are you, trad or jazz?
I'm strictly trad, man, absolutely. I'm afraid I'd like it very much indeed.
Is this your first time at Bewley?
Yes, it is.
You come again?
Yes, certainly. I love it.
Good.
Great.
There's so many people here, they just don't seem to want to listen. It's the trouble. They come here and they pay 12 and 6 a time. And they ought to listen to the music.
What do you think?
Well, they spoil it. They pay 12 and 6. They spoil it for everybody else. They just make complete fools of themselves.
You're both keen jazz fans, aren't
very
you?
Very much so.
Like listening to music.
We came here to listen to jazz and
not
see
this,
a lot of
and see bottles stupid, thrown and
stupid
stone.
People
By 1961, even the most successful musicians were beginning to worry about the trap in which they found themselves. Acker Bilk was quoted as saying, "It's all happened too quickly. The boom has brought out bands not really ready for public appearances." Ken Collier, the reluctant father of the whole thing and the one to gain the least from it commercially, was predictably more forthright. "A lot of overzealous and inexperienced promoters are taking hold of trad jazz, and if we're not careful, we'll beat it to death in 6 months." He was over-pessimistic or over-optimistic, according to one's viewpoint. It would be another 2 years before the slump. But already, under the surface, the movement which was to supplant and almost obliterate trad was beginning to germinate. In Liverpool, some young men had got together to form a group based on their enthusiasm for the recordings of modern American rhythm and blues. They called themselves the Beatles. By 1963, it was all over by the shouting. The Beatles had triumphed, the Rolling Stones, the Who, the whole rock movement followed in their wake. Nothing illustrates the rise and fall of trad quite so clearly as the annual programmes at the Royal Albert Hall. John Lennon had announced early on that he hated jazz, and most of his followers agreed with him. For them, young, rebellious, immensely excited by the energy of the new music, jazz seemed stuffy, set in its ways, predictable. Jazz was for swats and good boys. There'd come to be a lot of truth in these assertions.
Right, so you didn't fancy yours. Well, I didn't fancy mine much, but she didn't make me throw up.
Everyone here likes trash. Oh, come on, admit it. Rock was just a craze.
Bollocks. They'll be playing rock years after all that crap has been bombed and banned.
You're still playing your mouth organ, then?
How did trad react to this tremendous onslaught? The famous bands went into cabaret and spent a lot of time on the continent where the impact of rock, while strong, was less conclusive. Lesser bands folded or scratched a bare living playing long hours in sleazy clubs, mostly in Germany. In Britain, promoters changed their policy almost overnight and went over to rock, or beat music as it was called then. Clubs folded. Jazz had become a dirty word. It was pronounced dead, but it wasn't quite.
Oh, yes, there were some very lean periods, but, there was still enough people interested to make it worthwhile playing, as long as you've got an audience to play to. And you found you was pleasing somebody, that's the main thing.
Very gradually, towards the end of the 60s, after surviving the shock of the rock explosion, jazz cautiously and with more modesty emerged. The second rock generation, with no battle to win, was prepared to listen to it with tolerance.
I remember you take... When I used to do Kingston, I remember the couples that came here, they were courting couples. I remember when they got married, some of them, they asked me to their weddings, I used to go on to their weddings. They turned up with their babies in arms, then they turned up with their children as they got bigger. I've had quite big louts come out of the audience, and they come up to me and they say, my dad took me here. And I know by the music they were talking about that they were speaking the truth.
Jazz is like a seaside pool. The great tides sweep in, obliterating it completely. Hardly anyone remembers it's there. But then the tide ebbs, and there it is again, a pool teeming with life.
All these different things have come and gone, and jazz is the one thing that's remained there. And any time there's a gap in the traffic and there's nothing much happening, you'll find that jazz comes forward and makes its mark again.
I'm not literary enough to be able to explain how I feel about the music now. But it is, to me, it is a part of life, a way of life. It's an expression.
The pleasure of it is endurable, always. I mean, I think it must be. When you hear those marvellous things, you can't ever not respond to them.
It gives me magical moments. I still get that shiver up me back when I put on a certain record, and I've probably heard it 100 times, and I shall never tire of that.
Jazz has survived and is doing, in a quiet way, well. There's more tolerance, less dogmatism now. In most cases, the ideological battles of long ago are forgotten. Ronnie Scott's club, in its early days the bastion of modern jazz, employs all schools. The festivals cover the field from New Orleans to avant-garde without fear of mayhem. Jazz has surprised the doctors. And three times a week, here at the Lord Napier, Bill Brunskill still blows his horn. Thank you.
Yes, I'm still the same.